Us to come to him for guidance, for strength, and for direction. stay focused on what's important. In a small Wisconsin town on the southern shore of Lake Superior, the annual Dog Sled Derby was about to begin. The racers were all children, from older boys with several dogs and big sleds, to one little boy who had only a small sled and a dog. On the signal, the sled took off, and the little fellow was soon so far behind that he hardly seemed to be in the race at all. Then, about halfway through the race, when the second place team tried to move into first place, the sleds got too close together, and the dogs began to fight. As each of the other sleds in the race came upon the fight, more dogs got involved. The scene was soon one big seething knot of kids, sleds, and racing had vanished from the minds of the racers. However, the one little guy and his dog managed to skirt the others and went on to win the race. Wright Path founder and business coach Jerry Mabe tells employers that when they hire staff, they should look out for shiny object people. Why? Because like children, they are easily distracted by other things and the job suffers under their watch. To succeed, you must stay focused on what's important and pursue your goals without wavering or hesitating. Keep your eyes on the finish line, trusting God to help you. He will. His word says so. Because, this is a scripture, because the sovereign Lord helps me, I will not be disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like a stone, his will, and I know that I will not be put to shame. That's Isaiah chapter 50, verse 7. So I'm just gonna keep, I'm not really gonna offer too much commentary unless I like really want to. I'm just gonna keep reading. The next one is from October 8th, 2018, and this one is called Use What God Has Given You. Given you certain relationships, skills, experiences, and attributes that he wants you to use to fulfill his purposes. He used a beauty pageant to position Esther as Queen of Persia and stop the genocide of the Jews. He used He used Nehemiah's diligence as the king's cupbearer to position him for royal favor that would parlay into rebuilding the wall of Jerusalem. He used David's music ability to give him access to the king of Israel. He used Joseph's imprisonment as his ability to interpret dreams to save two nations from famine. He used the zeal of a mass murderer named Saul of Tarsus to spread the gospel via three missionary journeys while writing half the New Testament. And if God used them, he will use you too, and he wants to. In fact, he's cultivating talents within you that will serve his kingdom purposes in ways you are unaware of right now. It may be your God-given athletic abilities or music talent that God gives you to give you a platform to give him praise. It may be your creative genius. It could just be your good old-fashioned work ethic. No matter what it is, it's a gift from God that is to be used for God. Success is doing the best you can with what you have, where you are. It's not based on circumstances, wealth, power, or platform. It's not based on past experience or future potential. It's stewarding every opportunity in every way, every day. So today, use what God has given you. And that was the devotional that got me starting to think about making my second channel and using my knowledge of YouTube and editing and all that to make videos like this where I can kind of talk about this stuff. And that's why I made my second channel. So reading that one, that was where the wheels started turning. Okay, the next one is from October 10th, and it's called When You're Facing Opposition. Do you remember the old hit song by Elvis Presley, Don't You you step on my blue suede shoes. You won't get too far in life before somebody does that very thing and steps on your toes. But before you get discouraged and throw in the towel, take another look at the life of Jesus. Though he was perfect in all ways, he was criticized continually. His enemies called him a glutton and a drunkard. They even accused him of being possessed by a demon. Yet he never allowed bitterness or discouragement to defeat him. To him, every obstacle was an opportunity to demonstrate grace and grit. His heart was broken by those he loved, yet he understood and comforted others. He saw disease as an opportunity to heal those who were sick, hatred as an opportunity to love his enemies, temptation as an opportunity to overcome the carnal impulses we all deal with, and offenses as an opportunity to forgive. He went through life turning trials into triumphs. He's our example. The Bible says, "Consider him who endures such opposition, so you will not grow weary and lose heart." Pick up your Bible and reread his teachings. In his famous Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "You're familiar with the old written law. Love your friend and its unwritten companion. Hate your enemy." I'm challenging that. I'm telling you to love your enemies. Let them bring out the best in you, not the worst. Live generously and graciously towards others. That's how Jesus lived, and that's how he wants you to live too. A lot easier said than done. Next one is from October 23rd, and it's called Becoming Christ-like. If you could change through self-effort, you wouldn't need the Lord. Plus, any attempt on your part to earn or merit his grace disqualifies you. Why is that? Because you're striving to be the source of your own salvation, or your own significance, or your own strength. If you want to know what really upsets God, that will do it every time. So how on earth am I supposed to become more Christ-like, you ask? Die to self and allow Christ to live through you. Take a moment to ponder these scriptures. Those who think they can do it on their own end up obsessed with measuring their own moral muscle, but never get around to exercising it in real life. If God himself has taken up residence in your life, you can hardly be thinking more of yourself than of him. Anyone, of course, who has not welcomed God won't know what we're talking about. But for you who welcome him, in whom he dwells, even though you still experience all the limitations of sin, you yourself experience life on God's terms. It stands to reason, doesn't it, that if the alive and present God who raised Jesus from the dead moves into your life, he'll do the same thing in you that he did in Jesus, bringing you alive to himself. How can you tell that Christ is alive and working in you? When others look at you, they will see him. When they listen to you, they will hear him. And when they walk with you, they will be following him. How long does it take to become Christ-like, you ask? It happens a day at a time, over a lifetime. Okay, skipping ahead now to Halloween, October 31st. This one is called Celebrate Your Progress. This is kind of like an encouraging one. Lasting change doesn't come through human effort, frustration, self-hatred, guilt, or beating yourself up over your failures. It comes from having your mind renewed daily by the Word of God. If you're a consistent Bible reader, you'll grow spiritually. As you agree with God and believe what he says in his Word, you gradually begin to change. It just happens. You start to think differently, talk differently, and act differently. But you must be patient because it's a process that develops in stages. And you must learn to enjoy life while you're going through the transformation process. Many of us look like we're walking a tightrope rather than a pathway of peace. Enjoy where you are on your way to where you're going. this next line. Ready? Don't waste all of your now time trying to rush into the future. Jesus said that tomorrow will have challenges of its own. Perhaps you're thinking, if only I didn't have this problem, I'd be happy. What are you wrestling with? An out-of-control appetite? Resentment? Fearfulness? Maybe you're saying, if I could get this habit under control, I'd be fine. Just like Israel conquered the promised land one city at a time, you conquer your weaknesses one day at a time. Paul said, so I might finish my course with joy. Paul wanted to be all that God called him to be, but he wanted to enjoy the process. So instead of getting discouraged about how far you still have to go, learn to celebrate your progress. Doing the thing you enjoy most and doing it in a body that's forever energized. That's heaven, and the ultimate bliss will be seeing Jesus face to face. I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake and with thy likeness. That's Psalms 17:15. So that's why I'll sometimes hear Christians say, like, we live in this world, but we're not of this world. Like, that's kind of where that stems from. Okay, November 13th is called Be Patient. You're closer than you know to becoming the person God wants you to be. By His enabling grace, you'll make it through this trial and come out stronger and wiser. Paul says, if God is for us, who can be against us? That's Romans 8:31. God is for you. That means you can do the thing you're afraid you can't do. The prison bars you're beating against are in your mind, and since you put them up, with God's help, you can take them down. God wants to set you free from the fearful attitudes that have held you back for so long, to release you to live up to your full potential. The right attitude can overcome almost any barrier. For example, the Bible says love never fails. Why? Because love isn't dependent on your emotions or circumstances. It's a servant of your will. Love is a decision. Jesus said, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." And if Jesus commands it, He will enable you to do it, meaning He won't tell you to do something that you can't do. Beginning is usually the hardest part. The journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. After that, it gets easier. But look out, old attitudes will try to resurface and come back stronger than ever. Don't let them. Radio commentator Paul Harvey says, you can always tell when you're on the road to success. It's uphill all the way. So be patient. It will take time to get there, but anything worthwhile is worth working for. Boom. Okay, November 14th is called Receiving from God. I just have to show you the little, each one like comes with a little picture. I don't know if you can see that. It's a little boy. It's not gonna focus, but it's a little boy. He's like lifting a really big weight. It's cute. Okay, receiving from God. In order to receive what God has promised in His Word, you need to do three things. First, make up your mind. Take hold of His promise and don't let go. Be tenacious. God responds to a faith that perseveres and a mind that's made up. With God, all things are possible. Former baseball star Sam Ewing said, "Nothing is as embarrassing as watching someone do something that you said couldn't be done." Second, visualize your victory. Before construction starts, the architect already has a picture of the end result in mind. By faith, Abraham saw his children. He counted them every time he looked up the stars. Abraham was told that he would have children, but he didn't have them yet. So by saying he saw his children, he like had a vision of them in his mind. He had faith that he would have children one day. That's what that means. Use your memory to replay past victories and your imagination to pre-play future ones. That's what David did when he slew Goliath. Look your giant, whatever difficulty you're facing, look your giant squarely in the face and declare, "You're coming down in the name of the Lord." Third, speak to your situation. Jesus said, "Whoever says to this mountain, obstacle, be removed and cast into the sea, and does not doubt, but believes those things he said will be done, he will have whatever he says." Notice, Jesus used the word believe more. Pause, we're gonna read that again. Notice, Jesus used the word believes once, but referred to what you say three times. Could that be because we already know so much about believing, but need to learn more about how to speak in into your situation. Don't just talk about your mountain, talk to it. Line up what you say with God's word, make his word your word, and the mountain will become your servant. It has to. Jesus said so. Okay. I have two more. This one is from November 17th, and it's called When Someone Attacks You. There are two kinds of criticism: constructive criticism and destructive criticism. One builds you up, and the other tears you down. Be wise in how you respond to unfounded criticism and gossip. When your critic wants to remain anonymous, they're not worthy of your response. I'm gonna read that again. When your critic wants to remain anonymous, they're not worthy of your response. The story is told of a pastor who received a letter that contained only one word: foul. Next Sunday, he held it up and said to the congregation, "I received the strangest letter this past week." He read the one word text and said, "Somebody wrote it and forgot to sign it." You say, "But they are attempting to hurt my reputation." D.L. Moody said, "If I take care of my character, God will take care of my reputation." Anytime you're involved in a worthy cause, people will not only try to beat you down, but keep you down. In training Timothy for ministry, Paul told him to endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Difficult people are placed in our path not to defeat us, but to develop us. Leaders know this, so they stay and finish the job regardless of the cost. Just like the captain goes down with the ship, the true leader stays until the work is done. You say, "Then how should I respond?" By praying for them. Jesus said, "Bless those who curse you, and pray for those who spitefully use you, and you will be sons of the Most High." That is like the hardest thing to do ever. Like, if someone comes at you, you want to like take them down, but you're actually supposed to do the opposite. Okay, last one is December 18th, 2018, and it's called Visited by an Angel. This one I just think is interesting. One day, Debbie Gass was driving through Nevada when her sports car ran out of gas. A young woman, alone in a small car, on a desert highway, with no one around. It had all the elements that cause us to be afraid. Soon, a big tractor trailer pulled up and a 6-foot-tall driver got out and asked, "Can I help you, lady?" When she explained her predicament, he told her to lock her car and come with him to a service station a few miles up the interstate. What to do? The voice of God within her, a voice she'd learned to trust, whispered, "It's okay, go with him." As they drove together, the man told her he'd been in prison, met Christ, and his life had been radically changed. He showed her pictures of his wife and family. When they returned to her car, he poured a can of gas into her tank, said goodbye, and left. Then it happened. Just as Debbie turned her car around to leave, on a highway with a clear view for miles in either direction, the truck was nowhere to be seen. Just like that, a 40-ton tractor trailer and its driver disappeared. The Bible says, "Don't forget to show hospitality to strangers, for some who have done this have entertained angels without realizing it." Debbie is convinced God sent an angel to help her that day. What do you think? Many of us have similar stories, yet we don't share them. Maybe it's fear of criticism, or maybe it's not until later that we realize we had, in fact, been visited by an angel. And that is pretty much all I'm going to share with you in this video. If you would like me to read more of them in the future, I can definitely do that if you enjoyed this. And I know a lot of you keep saying, like, you want to see more, like, faith or Christian-based ASMR videos. So let me know what you would want to see, because I can't really think of that much that I could do, but just let me know. So I will leave the link to my Bible study video in the description if you have not seen it yet, and I will also also leave the link to the video on my second channel about how my second channel is not an ASMR, by the way, but I made a video about how to start doing your own Bible study at home on your own, because I know some of you mentioned that you want to do it, but you just have no idea where to start, and I get that. That's honestly the hardest part, so I will leave all those links down in the description, and let me know your thoughts.